Welcome to the lecture recital at South Open College, and welcome to all joining us electronically. My name is Godfrey Chow, I'm the Visiting Department Chair. Today is my honor and privilege to introduce you the presenter, Professor Richard Janicki. Professor Janicki is our own percussion instructor. He received his master's degrees in percussion performance, magna cum laude, from DePaul University. Professor Janicki is a longtime member of the Illinois Philharmonic Orchestra and Northwest Indiana Symphony Orchestra. Also, he frequently performs with the Lyric Opera, Geoffrey Ballet, Grant Park Symphony Orchestra, Elgin Symphony Orchestra, and Chicago Symphony Orchestra. At the end of his presentation, we'll have a few minutes for comments and questions from you. If you are in the theater, you just need to raise your hand and someone will give you a microphone to speak. For those who are watching on YouTube, you can log in to a YouTube account, then type and capitalize the word question before you type the actual question, so that Ms. Tasson sitting there will read your question to him. Without any further ado, please join me in welcome Professor Janicki.
That's striking drums. I'm also going to actually basically rub or scrape the drum with brushes. Just to add another dimension to it so we can actually hear what it sounds like when you shake something, and then we can add the drums into it. And then lastly, I'm going to use a whistle, because percussionists are often called upon to blow the whistles and different sound effects. Because I said lastly, but I have one other thing I want to introduce before we get started in the realm of percussion. The last thing I played was a samba, and that brings us to our first instrument we're going to talk about today, which is used in samba music. And starting with the letter A, we're going to go from A to C through a bunch of different percussion sounds, some of our effects, some of our actual more involved instruments. But the very first thing we're going to talk about is the agogo bells. There's actually two bells, high and low. And this instrument is basically used in Brazilian music during Carnival. There's big, huge samba bands, maybe about 50 to 60 people. They may actually have like three or four people just playing agogo bells. And just to give you a couple of sounds that they use, this is actually a rhythm they would use during what would be properly a samba. Another one would be a partito alto. That's a little hard to follow, but. And then lastly, I have a marca two, and that's what this one sounds like. Now, I'm going to play a little track for you that actually uses the agogo bells with the entire band. This is a group out of New York, actually appropriately called, the last thing I mentioned, America 2 New York. Thank you. Kindig, a very prominent right here at Kindig, which is why I chose that piece. Next instrument, letter B. We have a belchery. You may or may not be familiar with this instrument. It's literally a tree of bells. If you rang in a hotel and you rang it for the concierge, you might hit a bell. And, but these are a series of them, laid out from small, obviously up to large. And generally, the way it's played is the way I'm going to demonstrate right now, which is this way. You run very quickly along it. And it kind of creates what I would call like a magical sound or a magical effect. And that's generally where it's used is in movies. A Tinkerbell flashed across the stage, they might use that sound effect. I just want to call real quick attention. A lot of times there's a little bit of confusion as these two instruments, which is why I have this one out. This is called a mark tree, not to be confused with a bell tree. And this is that. This is the mark tree sound. It's a little more delicate, but just so there's no confusion, it's also sometimes called the wind chimes. So we have the bell tree and then sometimes mark tree, but not to be confused. Our next instrument, the letter C, it's cymbals. I'm sure most of you are at least have heard the sound of a cymbal. I brought a wide variety today just to give you an idea of some of the sounds that are out there. This is what's called a smash cymbal. It's very tiny. It kind of quickly goes through some of these sounds. It's a little bit bigger splash sound. The next cymbal, this is a little more interesting. It actually has to, it's hard to pick this up, but the edge of the cymbal has been bent backward. And this creates like a gong sound. And that's called a Chinese cymbal. This is a more typical cymbal you can find in your band, orchestra, or the drum set, or something like this. It's just a suspended cymbal. But obviously a suspended cymbal can be played in many different ways, I'm sure some of you are aware. It can be hit on the bell, which is this round portion up here. You can strike that part of it. You can strike it with the shoulder of the stick, which is this part of it, which gives a little bit more of almost like a cowbell sound. You can just strike it at the edge, you can hit it like that. There's a lot of sounds you can get out of it. But I want to play one specifically today, and that is, which probably a lot of you are not familiar with, this is a cello bow. You can actually take the cello bow and actually, this is like scraping it or rubbing it. And you get a really unique sound. And I'm trying to get it. It's kind of a quiet sound. But that's a fact you might find in like a movie soundtrack or a scary movie or something like that when something scary is about to happen. And that's the sound of using the bow on the cymbal. Lastly, as far as cymbals, if you've ever been in marching band, I'm sure you've seen cymbals like this. This is a pair of cymbals. This is how cymbals are actually used, like when we first started using cymbals back in ancient times, because the cymbals are a very ancient instrument. In fact, I'm not necessarily a Bible person, but I looked this up in Psalm 150. It says, "Praise him with loud cymbals." And it's actually a quote from Psalm 150, so I'm assuming it's pretty ancient. So I'm going to go ahead and play a loud cymbal. That was a loud cymbal crash. That was actually a soft cymbal crash. This is a loud cymbal. This is a little more interesting, this instrument. This is D, and D is for either darabuka or a dumbek. This particular instrument is a darabuka, but I prefer to use the word dumbek only because the difference between it is this is a metal instrument, and a dumbek is made out of clay. But basically they're the same exact shape. They're both from the same region of the world, which is mostly Middle Eastern. And typically they're used to accompany belly dancers. I'm just going to give you a sound. So dumbek, the reason it's called a dumbek is because basically the two sounds you get out of the instrument are a doom or a beck, which is hitting it at the edge. So you combine those two sounds and kind of get a rhythm going. And is the dumbek. Next, the letter E. When I was researching this and putting this together, E was a tough one. There aren't a whole lot of instruments that actually, percussion instruments that start with the letter E. But I found these guys. And these are egg shakers. So That's the letter E. And basically what it is one of those little plastic eggs you might find in your Easter basket. And what they've done is they put little bits of sand or some kind of beads, or I'm not sure exactly what's in it. I don't want to open it because it's all over the floor. But it creates a shaker sound, which hopefully you've maybe heard, I'm assuming, but this is the sound of an egg shaker. It's very soft. And then this one's a little bit louder. And you can combine the two. Or you can put it in your hands like this, and cup your hands around it, leave it open, and you can do this, make it a little bit louder. And then you can close your hand around it, and it muffles the sound. And then you can kind of open and close it, it sounds like this. You get some kind of unique sound out of just these little guys, these egg shakers. Our next instrument is the letter F. And this instrument, I'm going to probably guess that most people are not very familiar with it because it is not used a whole lot in the percussion realm. I've only been called on to play it in my 50 years of playing, I think, once. And this is what's called a flexitone. And what it is a piece of metal. It's been welded into this other frame handle thing. And then there's these two red beads that are attached to metal also. And basically how this instrument is played is by shaking it like this. Hopefully you can pick it up the pitch, so you can actually increase the pitch as by pressing on the metal, and it makes it tight. I guess the metal, I'm not exactly sure how it works, but basically the sound, the pitch goes up. A lot of times it's used in comedic effects, sort of like this. You might see it like a cartoon or something like that. But the flexitone, actually somebody took this very seriously. Cacciatore, who's a composer, in his piano concerto, in the second movement, he actually uses the flexitone prominently. So we need cue number two. Listen carefully. Caught the flexitone in there. And that part is actually rather difficult because, as you know, that instrument, I'm assuming maybe you can tell, there's no way to really gauge where you are, so it's all a feel thing. I'm sure the person that played that part can spend a lot of time doing that. Next instrument is the güiro. I would imagine some of you who play percussion would be familiar with this instrument. This is an instrument that basically is designed to be scraped. So, this is a basic güiro, and basically it's used in Latin, a lot of the Latin American bands use it, and Caribbean bands, and it's used mainly by scraping across this ridge surface. You get this sound. And then you can play a little rhythm with it. And to create other sounds with it, you can actually use other implements. This is a type device, and it creates a harsher sound. So if you add a really loud grow part, just a little bit fuller sound. And I brought one other one today, that's a little bit larger grow. This actually has three different surfaces you can describe. That one, this one, which is tighter, and this is part of the basic striking area. But they come in different shapes and different sizes. That's the grow. Next, go ahead and walk back here. Alright. Next is a hi-hat, letter H. And the hi-hat is part of a drum, usually part of a drum set or drum kit. There's different things you can do with a hi-hat. In fact, I'll tell you a little of the history of the hi-hat. It actually started out, originally, players would play with a bass drum and a cymbal attachment, and then eventually that evolved into starting using pedals on the bass drum, and then they decided to use a pedal with the cymbals. And that's how it sort of evolved. The original cymbals were actually about 6 inches off the ground, and they called it a low boy. And then eventually, I think somewhere in the mid-20s, somebody got the right idea to actually put it up higher. And that sense of the term became high boy, and eventually, for whatever reason, hi-hat. That's a little history of it. But some of the basic sounds you get off a hi-hat are for jazz. They'll usually use like a jazz drive cymbal, and then they'll add what's called a chick. That's one basic sound by just moving the pedal. You can also just hit the hi-hat cymbals. And then you can slowly open the cymbals more to get kind of a squishier, crunchier sound. Those are some of the different sounds. And then another technique is actually open and close while you're playing on it, like so. So those are some of the sounds we get out of the hi-hat. All right, next instrument is actually literally an iron pipe. You can get this at the plumbing store or something like that. It's literally just a piece of pipe. But when you hit it with something very hard, like these giant brass pellets, it makes a very sharp sound, and in fact, what it's really trying to do is imitate the sound of an anvil. So if you're making a sword, and you're trying to pound out your sword on this anvil, it's going to make some kind of a sound similar to this. Yeah, it's pretty brutal. And that's usually where it's used. But I have two examples today I want to use with the iron pipe. It's not visually that interesting. But the first one comes from an actual serious piece of music that Perez wrote. And it's actually just for percussion instruments, and it's called ionization. So if you hear Q3. This is probably the way it's more used in like movie soundtracks, and it's much more of a brutal effect into maybe accents of brass songs and stuff like that. So you can play the next cue. This is probably the most unique instrument you're hearing today, and this is literally the jawbone of a burro. Hopefully, led a long life before it turned into a jawbone. It's also called a quijada, and the way you play this instrument is the teeth are loose, and what happens when you strike the side of the jawbone is going to rattle like this. And that's the actual teeth rattling. That's one of the ways we play it. Another way you can play it is to actually just scrape like we did the guitar. Probably not as loud because it's not a sound chamber sort of underneath it, but that's the quijada. Now there's a modern version that maybe some of you have heard, and it's not really used all that often, but it's used to great effect. And this is called the vibra slap, and it's sort of the modern version of the quijada. And the way this instrument works is there's a wooden sound chamber, and there's little metal rods that are going to vibrate when I strike it like this. And there's one tune that's, I think, pretty famous. I know they played a lot in NFL games. Let's hear the next cue. And this is probably the most prominent example I can think of a vibra slap. It's basically a solo. Probably one of the few times that the vibra slap has ever been used as a solo instrument. Our next instrument, moving right along, is the letter L. And this is not exactly, it's a log drum, but this is not the version of typical log drum. The original ones are typically from Africa, Polynesian culture, and Hawaii, that kind of regions, use basically a hollowed out log. And then they create tongues, which this does have. And the tongues are just wooden slits cut in, you know, that hollowed out. This is a box chamber. And it's generally used to accompany dancers, maybe hula dancers or something like that. But this is the sound of a log drum. And there's a high pitch and a low pitch. Sometimes they have more, sometimes they have less, but typically maybe 2 to 4 or something in that range. But anyway, you can just kind of create a little rhythm with it. That's the sound of a log drum. Next is much more involved instrument than anything we've seen so far, and that is this instrument, which is also made of wood, just like our log drum. But this instrument actually has many more pitches available. This obviously instrument had 2. This has, I never actually counted, but somewhere around 40-something, 7, 48, something like that, bars made out of wood. And this instrument is called a marimba. And it originally came out of Africa. The original ones actually were actually usually just wooden planks laid over sometimes a pit or across maybe hay or something like that. So it's not going to be as resonant as this one. In fact, this instrument has, across the front of it, has these resonators which help actually bring out the sound of the bar, because without the resonator, it's not really as loud. So I'm going to play a little piece by Mitchell Peters called Dragonfly on the marimba. Associated with it, but in operas. Puccini's Mad Butterfly actually has a fairly prominent nightingale whistle part, and also Mozart's Magic Flute uses it too. And the sound sounds something like this. And that's what a nightingale sort of sounds like. And then there's another version of it. But that desolation is the water inside of it. I think to pull it out. That's what. Now that I'm done with it. Because it's very, you have to be very careful how you put the water into it. Anyway, that's the nightingale whistle. There's another effect on the keyboard instrument. This is the these are the orchestra bells. And they differ from the marimba in that it's actually a metal bar. These are actually metal bars, and they're laid out just like the marimba, but they're much, much higher pitched. In fact, I believe it's the highest pitch I think you can get in a band or orchestra. Because it actually, where you see it written, it's actually two octaves above that. So wherever you see, wherever the part is, it's actually quite a bit above that. I'm going to play a couple little excerpts from a couple of things. The first one is from Glasnow's Violin Concerto, and this one utilizes the orchestra bells in a very soft manner. I'm just going to play a couple of little parts from this. That's done with a very small mallet, and it's a very light part. The next example I'd like to play on the orchestra bells is something much different than that, and this is going to be pretty loud. That's all I'm going to tell you. And this comes from Paul Lucas, Sorcerer's Apprentice, which some of you may have seen from Fantasia. It's definitely featured in Mickey Mouse Land, I know that. And that is Sorcerer's Apprentice by Paul Lucas. Cascading water in the actual musical score. So those are orchestra bells. Next, parade drum. Okay, next instrument could go by several names. Could be called a field drum, could be called a snare drum, but today I'm going to use the term parade drum, which is definitely a term that I see in parts. And it is a large drum. It has snares on it. This particular drum actually has a natural head, so it's made out of calf skin, both the top and the bottom, which you don't see on most modern drum sets and modern drums. But these are natural skins. I purchased them to reflect more of the nature of this drum. This drum is probably from the 1930s. It's an old military drum, actually. Anyway, I'm going to put this on. I'm going to demonstrate it by playing something called three camps. I'm only going to play actually I was going to play the third camp from three camps in this three camps, and this particular piece actually is used for reveille to wake people up. So it might wake you up, but we'll find out. So here we go. By a person that really knows how to play one. I've had to play it once, but it takes years to actually master the tweak up. And this track will demonstrate what a tweak is actually capable of playing. Hang on, you know what? You're Jordan, I'm sorry, I skipped letter K. Just go to the next track. If I don't get the K, that's okay too. Sorry about that.
Armando o coreto e preparando aquele feijão preto, eu tô voltando. Põe meia dúzia de grama pra gelar, muda a roupa de cama, eu tô voltando.
So if you heard all this interjection between the singing, that was a cuica playing a cuica. And it almost sounds like a human voice, sort of, or sometimes a monkey too. I'm not going to go back to K. So, all right, we're just going to move right ahead. So the next instrument I have is rototoms, and that's what these are. And rototoms were basically invented back in the 50s, and the person who invented them actually was a former teacher of mine, Al Payson, along with a couple other gentlemen. And the idea was he was trying to come up with an idea of being able to tune a drum rather rapidly. Because normally with a drum, you have to take a key and actually tighten the head at each tension rod. And that takes a lot of time, so if you're trying to maybe practice something like timpani, which is what the idea was, you need to be able to change the pitch rather quickly. So with these drums, you can literally rotate, that's the name rototom, you can actually just rotate the drum to change the pitch. So you can actually change the pitch almost instantly. Now, I'm not going to play anything today, but I have a track from a gentleman that I think used about 8 rototoms, and a tune called Time by Pink Floyd. So the next track. These are nothing more than spoons you find in your cabinet. And these are generally used with definitely ethnic groups, Greek, Russian, Turkey. They typically would be used to accompany, say, a person playing maybe guitar or accordion or fiddle. And you basically just take the two spoons and kind of sandwich them between your fingers. I'm going to find a spot here. And you're basically going to take one hand and then take the spoons and rack them and sort of spread them in between your leg and your hands like this. That's the sound of spoons. Next we have one of the bigger instruments out here, and that is timpani. And timpani are sort of they were developed sort of over time back in the about the 15th century, and they were used for military uses to drive like any soldiers or when they're marching to keep them in time. And then later developed into, they started being incorporated into the orchestra or bands, and they were always associated with trumpets. So if you hear like early orchestral music, it's typically the trumpets are always with the timpani. Later, it got a little more involved for timpani. In fact, I'm going to play just a short little, part for Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And it's actually a timpani solo. So now I think this would be like 1826, somewhere in that range. The timpani actually were used in a soloistic way, and that's the sound that I'm going to just demonstrate right now, which is this. Actually, in Beethoven, if you listen to this, I think it's the third movement of Beethoven or second movement, I can't remember. But anyway, that's one of the ways they're used. And then today I brought, actually, I'm going to demonstrate one other thing we played. This is what's called a glissando. And you basically just take, because these drums have pedals, they're incapable of doing this effect, which is called a glissando. Another one of those sounds that you probably hear in like comedy, maybe somebody falling down, but this is a glissando. A couple of years ago, I was called on to do something I've never even thought of doing on a timpani, and that is to take a super ball, a little stick, and you can rub it on the instrument, and it creates a pretty creepy sound, I would say. It's probably the best way to describe it. That's generated by just rubbing on the timpani head. So those are timpani. My next instrument. Okay, well, my next instrument had a little problem with this. I was going to bring what was called voodoo. And due to global supply chain issues, I could not get a voodoo. I tried to order one back in January for this, and due to, I guess, the supply chain issues, it's not going to come until May. So we're in March, not going to come. So I came up with the brilliant idea, okay, how about using the word underwater? Since you can dump percussion instruments in water and it changes or bends the pitch. And this is just your standard chime from a rack of chimes. I'm going to hit it just the way it normally sounds. So it sounds like a doorbell, maybe a chime or something like that, or a church bell. But when you put it in water, that's what's in the bucket, and you're going to hear what happens to the pitch. It actually bends the pitch of the chime. So that's underwater chimes. All right. This is the next instrument. It's the vibraphone. And the vibraphone is another, like I played Arch Falls earlier, the vibraphone is another metallic instrument. This one sort of evolved in the 1920s. And 30s, I guess. And what it was trying to do was create a little warmer sound at the bells. It's a pretty harsh sound. This is going to be a much warmer sounding instrument. And a couple other things they added to the instrument to, improve on it or make it more versatile, more like a piano, is they put a pedal on it. And the pedal actually allows the bar to ring or stop ringing. So you can actually stop the sound. You can't really do that with an orchestra bells. And so that's called a damper pedal. And then also what they did, the name vibraphone, sometimes called vibraharp, they added the ability to add vibrato to the instrument. And this is kind of, it's gotten to the point where it's almost like, if you're playing something from the 30s or 40s, you might want to add it, but in modern times you really don't use it. But this is what the vibrato sounds like when you add it to the instrument. That's a pretty fast vibrato. And I'm going to slow it down. I'm going to play a song called, or a tune on the vibraphone called Reminiscing by Harry Brewer. And this tune was written in the 1930s. So that's why I'm going to use this vibrato effect on the instrument. Quintets. And it seems like you can use a saxophone, but maybe a bandleader would rather have the sound of the vibraphone. And this is a tune, it's called Bobby Hutcherson's Atrium Number 1 by Dick Sisto. Bobby Hutcherson is a vibraphone player of note. And this is a piece that he wrote to imitate Bobby, the way Bobby Hutcherson plays the instrument. And I'm only going to use two mouths in this excerpt. And anyway, this is Atrium Number 1 by Dick Sisto. isn't a whole, there aren't a whole lot of percussion instruments with the letter Y. So the best thing I can come up with is this yellow whistle. So at least it is a little Y. And it imitates the sound. I'm sure we're going to get it right away, but the sound of a gun. That's a yellow whistle. And then finally, letter Z. Turns out there is a letter Z. I didn't know this for sure, but now I do. It's a zil, which is another name you could use for this our finger symbols. And finger symbols are usually associated with dancers nowhere. Actually, a pair of them, their fingers, clap them along while they're dancing. But this is a very ancient instrument from back in the Greek and Roman days. And they would be played more like this, like clapped together like a pair of cymbals. But the way we usually play them to give it a little bit cleaner sound is to actually hit it on the edge, like this. So you don't get quite that clappy sound. Or sometimes I see people hit them this way. I have a couple of sets. These are a little bit bigger, a little bit louder, a little bit deeper sound. And these are a little bigger, but these are more typical like a dancer would use. But those are all zils. Anyway, that is, with the exception of K, I apologize for leaving out the K, I didn't mean to. Anyway, that is our A to Z percussion today. Thank you for coming out, especially Hillcrest High School and our people that joined us online. Hope you learned something today and enjoyed yourselves. But anyway, if you have any questions, I'm here to certainly answer any questions or maybe comments on something you heard today. Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
The Tom Brown that you were playing, fairly new instrument, the three right there.
Oh, these prototypes?
Yes. You played it with one out. Did you play it with more than one?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, there's pieces written for it. I mean, there's actual pieces you can play, but I looked into it and I thought, due to time constraints, it didn't seem all that interesting to play. But yes, people have actually taken a they're more like, they've kind of evolved into more of a little niche thing. And people, I think they've kind of made a little bit of a comeback lately, but they faded out for a while, I know, in the 90s and early 2000s. But they've kind of made a little bit of a comeback. So, because it's kind of a unique song. So, any other questions? Yes?
Which instrument was played, I thought Hampton famous for?
I'm sorry, what was that?
Which instrument was Lionel Hampton?
Oh, it'd be the vibraphone. Although I think he probably started on the xylophone, I think. He eventually moved into the vibraphone, which is this instrument, which I played a couple of things on, which is probably one of my favorite things to play. Any other questions? Yes?
How often with performances do you have to bring your own marimba? Or is it usually something that's set there for you to use?
In my younger days, I'd be happy to. My younger days, I would have maybe been happy to schlep this thing around. But I'll be honest, thank God it's here at the college because I would not have wanted to brought this today. It's a lot of work. In fact, I'll just tie to that question. The first thing I played was drum set. The reason is because that's probably the first instrument I actually started with was drum set and really got into high school and that kind of thing. And then found out about this other myriad of instruments, and then that's how it sort of developed for me. But I thought I was going to avoid carrying stuff around. That's why I wanted to stop playing drum set. And it turns out I carried more stuff today to put this thing on than I would have if I was just playing drum set. So it didn't work. Any other questions? Yes?
When you are learning, taking drum lessons, I know you probably start out with a regular drum, and then you need to take classes in, well, I know somebody that does a marimba, but the other ones too?
You
study it for a while?
I'll be honest, most collegiate institutions start with like marimba as a basic sort of instrument, and all the other instruments are sort of like, they're all similar, they're different sizes. But they're all relatively the same.
The one you can play one, you can move
on to another one. Right. Right. They are laid out a little differently. I never got into all the specifics, but the vibraphone is flat. I don't know if you noticed this. But this instrument is actually there's no raised surface, as opposed to the bells have a raised surface, the xylophone and the marimba all have the bar, the upper bars are raised. So it is a little bit different feel on the vibraphone, but it has to do with being able to mute muffle, I think, between, because the notes can ring. So I think that's why we did it that way. So, but yeah.
We do have an online question. The question is, do most percussionists learn all the instruments, or do they just focus on a few?
Well, you could certainly, focus on certain instruments, and then maybe that would be your main instrument. But if, what I do for a living is I play percussion, like with rather large orchestras. So I've been called on to play pretty much everything that I just played. I've definitely played everything that today. I've actually played it professionally with orchestras. So, you can focus on whatever you want. If you really like the vibraphone, I really like the vibraphone, but I can't really focus on that because it doesn't pay any bills necessarily. So when you're trying to be a professional, you have to make yourself saleable as best you can. So best to play more than less. So. All right. If there's no further questions, we're done for the day. Hopefully you had a good time. Thank you for coming out. And hopefully, if nothing else, you learned a couple things, or maybe you want to look into some of the stuff even further. So, but thank you for coming out.